Glad to see all of you this morning. Welcome you all to campus baptisms. Alright, there's not much announcement this morning. And we'll be having prayer singing. Dr. Stoffer bringing the word for us this morning. And if there's any visitors among us, I don't see, but if there's anyone, if you are there, we're happy about you. And we want to meet you after the service. Having said this, let us look to God in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this morning, the first Sunday of this month, especially a day that you have set aside for your children around the globe to gather together into your houses and to worship you. Heavenly Father, as we gather here with your promise of thy presence, we ask that help us to realize your presence in our midst and help us, Lord, to do all for your glory and for your honor. Help us, Lord, to sing hymns meaningfully, understandingly, the lines, the hymns, and also to listen to the singing or to the choir, especially to the masses, that we may give undivided attention to the words that come from this pulpit, from thy servant. We also pray that you would use thy servant who brings the word to us, that thy word may work in our hearts, and Lord, we may be edified and your name be glorified. We also do pray for those who couldn't come this morning. Wherever they are, you would bless them. As we begin this worship service, be with us from the beginning till the end. We pray this all in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. Somebody, please.
Let's all stand together and sing two hymns. We will start with hymn number two. That is Glory to His name.
Glory to His name. Glory
Thank you for the great singing. We will sing one more hymn. And after this hymn, I request the congregation to remain standing for the psalm reading. Hymn number 36, Low in the Grave He Laid, Jesus My Savior. When we come to the chorus, I think we will make a little bit faster. Up from the grave He arose. There we will a little bit fast, okay? Let's go ahead and sing.
Thank you for that beautiful hymns. We'll prepare our hearts this morning again to worship God with a psalm. We'll go to Psalm number 65. Psalm 65. It has 13 verses, so we will read them together. Verses 1 through 13, we'll read them together. If you're there, let's go to verse 1. Praise waited for thee, O God in Zion, and unto thee shall the vow be performed. O thou that hearest prayer, unto thee shall all flesh come. Iniquities prevail against me, as for our transgressions, thou shalt purge them away. Blessed is the man whom thou choosest and causest to approach unto thee, that he may dwell in thy courts. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of thy house, even of thy holy temple. By terrible things in righteousness wilt thou answer us, O God of our salvation, who art the confidence of all the ends of the earth, and of them that are afar off upon the sea, which by his strength setteth fast the mountains, being girded with power, which stilleth the noise of the seas, the noise of their webs, and the tumult of the people. They also that dwell in the uttermost parts are afraid at thy tokens. Thou makest the outgoings of the morning and evening to rejoice. Thou visitest the earth and waterest it. Thou greatly enrichest it with the river of God, which is full of water. Thou preparest them corn when thou hast so provided for it. Thou waterest the ridges thereof abundantly. Thou settlest the furrows thereof. Thou makest it soft with showers. Thou blessest the springing thereof. Thou crownest the year with thy goodness, and thy parts drop fatness. They drop upon the pastures of the wilderness, and the little hills rejoice on every side. The pastures are clothed with flocks. The valleys also are covered with corn. They shout for joy. They also sing. Thank you. Please be seated. It's a beautiful psalm that praises God with the abundance of blessings. And this psalm, if you see that, it's a lyrical poem of David. In the superscription itself, we see that a psalm and a song of David. It was written by David. However, the occasion of this psalm is unknown, and but still, writers or the commentators think as the narrative of the psalm, as we have read, is kind of, it was composed in the time of harvest festival, maybe the harvest of tabernacle. In those, for those festivals, maybe the psalmist David had penned down this particular psalm. David gives three reasons why praise is due to God. And some commentators made many more reasons, but I just view as three reasons, as we could see from this passage. And those three are, number one, verse number three, the psalmist likes to say, like here, praise him for his gracious salvation. In verse number three, we found it. And the second division is, the psalmist is saying, praise God because he answers the prayers. Verse number two and verse number five, we could see those. And the third division, praise God because of his constant creation care. And we see that verse 9 onward, the Creator is taking care of the created things, even us, God's people. So God cares for us. So with these reasons, let's look to God, verse number 1, as the psalmist says, why the praise is due to our Lord God Almighty. In verse number 1, first phrase, the psalmist says, praise waited for thee, O God in Zion. The word waited in Hebrew is dumia. And this morning, look at the Hebrew, attention caught in this word dumia. It's a feminine noun, and the meaning is silence, or still waiting, or repose. If you take the meaning of Hebrew, that means the Hebrew is like, to thee is silence prayer. And I was thinking, what does it mean? Does it mean silent praise? Yeah, we always, you know, all of us, God's people, used to praise God silently. Wherever we are, we could see the blessings of God. And though we sometimes not vocal, but we praise God silently. But however, the psalmist is not meant for God's people as they gather at Jerusalem, and especially at Zion, and as they're preparing for a worship, the psalmist doesn't mean that you, all of you should have a silent praise. It's not bad to have silent praise, but here the psalmist meant vocal praise. But in the vocal praise, why he used the word dumia, it has a great meaning. And the meaning seems to be going like this. It is kind of, you know, making ready everything for praise is getting ready, and all the preparations, like all was calmed down. Everyone who attended the worship service calmed down, and everybody kept silence, and every hearts were prepared for the worship, and when the hearts were filled with the deep sense of majesty and the goodness of God, and also the all feelings and anxieties of all the worshipers were calmed down and were kind of at the state of rest, and also the souls were ready to burst forth for the praise of God, and the only thing that the need of heart could be met is but praise. People could pray, so the congregation is entirely calm down, silence, and they're already under, you know, expectation is that as we do here, that someone stood up because of the goodness of God, because of the majesty of God, that stand up, get testimony, and praise the Lord. That praise is vocal, and everybody heard that prayer, and everybody said amen to that, you know, kind of testimony and a kind of praise. So that's the word the psalmist says here, that praise waited, dumia is silence for thee. Everyone is prepared. If, you know, everyone cannot praise, everyone cannot be vocal, but some of them, you know, vocal in the congregation, and everyone gave attention to that, to that testimony or that vocal, and everyone says amen. And that's what the preparation for the God Almighty for praise with the word here. I also like the word, the second phrase, that, and unto thee shall the vow be performed. The psalmist David mixed the word praise and vow in verse number one. And I also like to quote a few verses from other Psalms, Psalm number 22, verse 25, the psalmist says there, my praise shall be of thee in the great congregation. I will pay my vows before them that fear him. Here the psalmist also, make a promise, make a vow that he would praise the Lord before the congregation who feared the Lord. Psalm 50, verse 14, 50, verse 14, offer unto God thanksgiving and pay thy vows unto the Most High. Here also the psalmist is giving a promise, a vow to praise the Lord God Almighty. One more psalm to God, Psalm number 56, verse number 2, thy vows are upon me, O God. I will render praises unto thee. Here is again, the psalmist is giving a promise, a vow to God that, Lord, I will praise thy name. And it seems that the same meaning goes here. The psalmist David is making a vow or a promise here because of the judgments of God, because of the goodness of God. The psalmist David here makes a vow to praise the Lord. While he encourages others to praise the Lord, he himself makes a vow, a promise to God that, Lord, I will praise thy name among the congregation. Then verse number 3, as we have mentioned before, praise him for his gracious salvation. Verse number 2 is about hearing prayer. Verse number 3 about salvation. It says that iniquities prevail against me. As for our transgressions, thou shalt purge them away. Remember our sins. Remember the redemption. Remember the price that paid for our redemption on the cross of Calvary. All our sins, all our transgressions, as the psalmist knew it very well, that they are purged away. There are reasons after reasons the psalmist David gave here that the praise is due unto him. The second reason I mentioned before is the prayer answer. His prayers are answered. Third reason is about his constant care to all of us, not only to us, to also the created things. The Lord is taking care of everything. And also the psalmist beautifully concluded the psalms and, recognizing God's goodness and faithfulness. Friends, this morning, we have reasons after reasons, along with the psalmist David, that the Lord is good to us. The Lord saved us. He redeemed us. And he, you know, forgives all our transgressions and all our sins. He purges away. You remember all those blessings in our everyday life. The Lord is good to us. He is faithful to us. He cares for us. He blesses us with all the heavenly blessings. Remember those blessings. Let us give thanks unto the Lord. Shall we? Let's all bow down. And any willing person this morning again, you may take time to worship God. Yes, my brother. Yes, anyone. Yes, brother. Yes.
Heavenly Father, thank you so much for bringing me safely to your holy sanctuary this morning. Lord, as David writes in Psalm number 23, verse 4, yeah, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of the dead, I will fear no evil,
yes.
For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me.
Yes.
Lord, thank you so much for leading me through the valley of the shadow of the dead, Lord Father.
Yes.
Thank you so much for providing me all my needs, Lord Father. And Lord, especially thank you so much for your people who are staying in the U.S., for helping me in several ways, Lord Father.
Yes.
It is not possible if they did not help me. I couldn't able to resume my studies, Lord. Thank you so much for that. And Lord, thank you so much for loving a sinner like me. And Lord, even though my earthly father passed away, you are allowing me to continue his footsteps. Lord, for that reason, I praise your name. Lord, thank you so much for everything what you have done in my life.
Yes.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Thank you. Is there any other? Yes, brother. Yes, brother.
Lord, I come before you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Lord, many are thy wonderful works which thou hast done, and thy thoughts which are to us word.
Yes.
They cannot be reckoned up in order unto thee. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered.
Yes.
And Lord, innumerable evils have compassed about me. Mine iniquities have taken hold upon me,
yes.
So that I am not able to look up. They are more than the hairs of mine head.
Yes.
Therefore my heart faileth me, Lord. Indeed, Lord, you helped me, you delivered me from the evil and from the power of sin, Lord. Thank you for thy loving kindness, and thank you for your tender mercies, and thank you for your grace and mercy that you enable me to worship you, praise you. Lord, I give you all the glory, honor, praise unto you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yes, amen. Thank you. Any other? Yes, brother.
Our dear, precious Lord Father, I want to thank you and praise the Lord.
Yes.
Thank you for allowing us to come together in this morning. Lord, I thank you for your abundant love and all goodness. Lord Father, thank you for your sustaining in our life from the last 1 week, Lord. Dear Father, when you see in water, many people, many righteous people, many rich people, they want to come this day, Lord, but
yes.
They did not get these old things. What you've given us, Lord Father, we thank you for your greatness, love, Lord Father. As we are to worship you, help us to worship you through the Spirit, so it might be able to alive and
yes.
Applicable. Oh, Lord Father, once again, I submit to all your glory and honor. Oh, Lord Father, as we are going to listen to your word of God, Lord, help us to listen and help us to apply in our life. I thank you all a blessing, and thank you for your hear my prayer and answering. Jesus, most precious name I pray. Amen.
Yes. Thank you. Any other? Father, we thank you again for this morning, along with the psalmist David, in the times of harvest, when they see the plentiful and abundance, the blessings that thy children received, having seen those abundance of things, and they think, to whom due to praise. Lord,
You are the one that who provided everything for thy people, and we too, Lord, experience the blessings, the abundance of blessings in our everyday life. Lord, along with the psalmist David, we like to lift up our hearts towards you in full of gratitude and happiness because of thy blessings. We want to give glory, honor, and praise unto your holy name. Lord, you are so faithful to us. You are so good to us. We praise your holy name. We say thank you, God, for every single blessing that we receive in our everyday life. We give you glory and honor and praise in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you all. Today is the first Sunday of the month, so we have Lord's table. Let's open with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 11 again. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. We'll read from verse number 23. And we'll see six things from there, and then we'll go to the table. We'll participate. For I have received of the Lord that which also I deliver unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, this do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do so the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. May the Lord bless us. And with this, we'll just quickly view six things we can pick up from this, why we do or participate in the Lord's table. The first thing from verse number 24, as the Lord has commanded, the Lord has ordained, make it as ordinance for the church, and gave us command in verse number 24 that take it, and in the last phrase, this do in remembrance of me. So we are to do this as the Lord has commanded, as the ordinance of the church, that we, so the church, need to remember the Lord. The second thing is that already mentioned, to remember our Lord. Verse number 24, we read that. And verse number 25, the last phrase again, 24, last phrase, 25, last phrase, in remembrance of me, and also in do this in remembrance of me, in 24. In two places, we are to remember, as the Lord commanded us. And as we know that, we have to remember the unparalleled death of our Lord Jesus Christ on our behalf. The participation in the Lord's table does not remove our sins, or it does not impart grace, as some other denominations taught. It is nothing kind of mystical or supernatural or miraculous happens when we partake the Lord's table, but as we are told, it is to remember what he has done for us. The third thing is that to proclaim or to show the death of Jesus. In verse number 26, we read that, for as often as ye eat this bread, drink this cup, ye do so the Lord's death till he come. It's a kind of proclamation. Or showing to the world, maybe with the visual object, the Lord's death and his resurrection, especially his death, his body, which was, you know, crushed for us, and his precious blood, which was shed for the remission of our sins, we are proclaiming to the world of regarding salvation, the gospel. The four things, in verse number 26 again, to look forward to the return of Jesus. As it mentioned here, verse number 26, last phrase, ye do so the Lord's death till he come. It's a kind of anticipation that the imminent coming of the Lord will come at any time. So till he comes, we are to partake the Lord's table in remembrance of what he has done for us. As we see the last time he did, our Lord Jesus Christ did this, you know, taking Lord's table with his 12 disciples, the night he was betrayed and the night before he was crucified. As we see from the Bible, the next time he's going to perform this Lord's table will be with us all, with all the believers in his kingdom. As he said in Matthew 26, verse 29, let me quote, but I say unto you, I will not drink henceforth of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. In the kingdom, we will be with the Lord, and we'll have this, you know, observance of the Lord's table with our Savior, and he would drink with us. The last one to do is that to examine yourselves or ourselves. We are to examine. We have to think that, we have to understand that we are taking the Lord's table in the worthy manner. Friends, we all err. We all make mistakes. However, with the Lord, there's plenty of forgiveness. If you knew that you are not living worthily in regards to the relationship with the Lord, we can, you know, take time and confess, be right with him, and we can participate in the Lord's table. Two things to remember. If you are born again, you can participate. And after you have born again, if you have obeyed the Lord in the waters of baptism, you can take part. And one more thing is to add is that if you're living right with the Lord, you can take part. If not, you can just, you know, examine yourselves, be right, make right with God, and you can participate in the Lord's table. Therefore, let us examine ourselves. Let's have a silent prayer, about a minute. And if there's anything between God and you, let's confess and be right. And let us participate in the Lord's table. Shall we? Silent prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for the institution of the Lord's table, that you have made it as one of the ordinances of the church. And the Lord, to participate to the table, we have to walk in accordance with your will. Many times we err. Many times we fail. We ask that you would cleanse us, make us worthy, that we may do it in the commemoration of our Savior's, of his death, and of his blood. We thank you for this hour. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I call our deacons to assist.
The passage
with the Lord Jesus the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." I request Sir Tongpi to pray for us.
Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you willingly take our sins upon yourself and bear our condemnation on behalf of us, and so that we may be made righteous before God the Father. Lord, this morning as we come before you, we acknowledge that we need your cleansing. So we pray that you would do that work in each one of our hearts, our life. And we also pray that may we take part in this table for your glory. This is what we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do we as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me." I request Sir Rajesh to pray.
Father, well, we want to thank you for this new month that you've given to us. We thank you so much for safely bringing us and the life that you've given to us. Lord, this morning we come to your presence. And Lord, as we take part of this table, and Lord, as we take this grape juice, we remind ourselves of the work that you have done on the cross by sending your Son. We thank you so much for redeeming us from the clutches of sin. And Lord, thank you so much for giving us that redemption. And thank you so much for the eternal life that you've given to us, Lord. We are so grateful for the love that you have shown and the way that you have done everything for us, Lord. Lord, we submit each of us into your caring hands. And we ask you that you would enable us so that we might continue to live for you. In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you. Heavenly Father, we thank you that this morning we could commemorate by participating the Lord's body and the Lord's blood in the ordinance of the Lord's table. We thank you for this ordinance. We thank you for your body that which was crushed and died for us and have taken all the penalties that we to receive, but you have taken them in our behalf. Also thank you for your precious blood which was shed for us for the remission of our sins, thereby making us thy children. We thank you, we praise you. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen.
Let us continue our worship service with the tithes and offering, and this time I'm going to invite our usher to come forward. Shall we all stand together once again, please? And I'm going to ask our brother Ernest to pray for this tithes and offering, please.
Gracious God, I thank thee for thy sustaining grace even to this time. Father, I thank you for thy grace, which is always enabling us to come before you and worship thy holy name. Father, I thank you for the blessings, spiritual blessings and physical blessings that you have bestowed upon us through thy Son, Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, from those blessings, as we have come before you, a little amount of money, Father, I pray that you would help us to give you with cheerful heart. And I pray that you would sanctify our thoughts and our motives and conscience so that we would give you with cheerful heart. I commit this time into your gracious hand. We thank thee and we praise thee. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. Let's go ahead and sing At the Cross. Let's sing together.
At last and did my Savior's die, and did my soul raise down, would he devote that sacred hand for such a world as I? At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rolled away. There by faith I received my sight, and now it was there by faith I received my sight. Now I am happy all the day. My concern in God is sun and sun his glorious in. When Christ the mighty maker's done, or men the creatures see. And the cross, and the cross that first showed light, and the burdens of my heart's rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. But drops of grief can ne'er repay the depth of love I owe. Here, Lord, I gave myself away, this all that I can do. At the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rose away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Thank you. Please be seated. This morning, we, the choir, would like to sing or present the first Christmas song, even though this is the month of September. So we would like to take you to the month of December and remember once again the birth of Jesus Christ. Most probably the song comes from Luke chapter number 2, when the angels announced or gave the message to the shepherd, and they gave a message, fear not, and such and such. And the last they mentioned is that suddenly there was, with the angels of a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And so we are going to sing entitled Angels' Carols. And the song starts with the question, have you heard the sound? The song is a little bit slow, but I hope this will be a great blessing for us. Let's enjoy it.
Thank you. Amen. I just now noticing what the background was all these times whenever we had the slide. Now we can see it. I know you appreciate it. It's something that has been needed for some time. I'm very thankful that we were able to get the new projector. This morning, I would like to continue the message that I started on Friday. But I will be spending more time this morning in Deuteronomy chapter 6 than I will be in Ephesians. We'll get to Ephesians chapter 6, but it's easy to remember Deuteronomy 6:4 and Ephesians 6:4. It kind of works very easily that way. I'm going to be entitling this, And Ye Fathers, and comparing Deuteronomy 6:4 through 9 with Ephesians 6:4. I will repeat just a little bit of what was said on Friday, enough to get the context for the message, and then we'll continue with it. This is how one seventh standard student answered this request on a test. Describe how Israel worshiped God in the wilderness. Now, when I mentioned this on Friday, there were a few people that caught the problem, and they chuckled. But I was a little concerned about the rest that didn't chuckle. So I'm going to just go ahead and put those down here. The answer that was given on the test was, of course, they had 9 o'clock Sunday school, 10 o'clock church, 6 o'clock evening service, and 7 o'clock Wednesday prayer meeting. You need to smile. If you don't, it's kind of an indication you're not quite sure what happened in the wilderness. Far, 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 far from this, all right? As that student could confuse what was done in the Old Testament with what is being done currently, likewise, people today, it's easy for us to assume that God commands the church or the Christian school to train our children. However, both the Old and New Testaments command a child's spiritual training be done at home. And we're comparing two passages, Deuteronomy 6 and Ephesians 6 as well. In Deuteronomy 6, I want you to notice a shift from all the Israelites as a group to each Israelite. For this, you need to know a little bit about the King James Version. At the time when it was written, there was in English the ability to tell the difference between singular and plural. And so every time they saw a singular in Hebrew or in Greek for the second person, they would say thee or thou instead of you. Today, we do not have that distinction, and it's up to us to try to figure out whenever we see you, is it talking to a group or is it talking to an individual? I have tried to highlight this so you can see this shift. He starts by saying, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. When he said, the Lord our God is one Lord, he is referring to us all as Israelites. We have one God. But then notice how dramatically he now, instead of talking to the group, talks to each individual at a time. And thou. If you hadn't noticed that before, please notice every time you see in the King James thou or thee or ye. Ye is plural. You might not have known that, but that's significant because that helps us to see a little bit more of what was in the original language that it was written in. But notice all the individual things that are said. And notice that those individuals do not include a whole group. At the beginning, he said, the Lord, our God, he included everybody. But now he's not talking to every individual that's in the group, but one group of people within the group. You'll see what I mean in a minute. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. And we recognize that as being repeated in the New Testament. And that's the requirement God gives for us. We have one love, and that needs to be God. As it continues, and these words, okay, he's talking, these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. So there are words that have to be in the heart. Now, do you realize that when the word heart shows up in the Bible, more than often it is not talking about feelings? You remember the first mention of the word heart in the Bible? God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth and that every imagination of the heart, imagination and thoughts of his heart, was only evil continually. Clearly, the first mention of heart is to the brain and to the thinking, all right? And so when it says, these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart, he's talking about the word has to be up here. You say, well, no, I have the word. I have it in my hand. I've got a Bible in my hand. Yes, that's good. But too often it stays there. The word has to come in here. As I think I mentioned on Friday, it has to be in here so well that if someone quotes a portion of a verse, you could find it in the Bible. I wondered, we have some Bible quizzing here. I wonder if we should start doing that. We'll give a portion of a verse, a well-known verse, and we'll give 1 point if you get the book. We'll give you 2 points if you get the book and the chapter, give you 3 points if you get the book, chapter, and verse. Now, that would be an interesting indoor game, I think. But that's how they did it in the Old Testament. They didn't have chapters and verses like we have. You couldn't turn to Joshua 1:8. You'd have to say, in this book of the law, and so forth, and they would catch on to where you're supposed to be. So these words need to be in thine heart. We would call this memorizing, would we not? How much of the Bible do you have in here? I've pondered that myself, personally. If I were put in solitary confinement, which means I'm in a jail somewhere, I might not even have any light There's no one else there. I'm by myself. And there I am for days and weeks and months. What would I be able to remember from the Word of God? How much do I have memorized? And although I work regularly on memory, I wonder how I would hold up after weeks and months. But it shall be in thine heart, and thou shalt teach them diligently. That's really just one word in Hebrew. And it's a little bit of a puzzle, because it can mean a couple things, and I put both meanings down here. It can mean to repeat, or to almost inscribe something, cut something out of the wood to make a shape or something from wood. And we have here the idea of thou shalt teach them diligently. It's not something that is careless, but it is deliberate, and it's repeated, and it's strong, and so forth. This has the idea of teaching them diligently, but who's the them? Well, the them here is the words, but teach them diligently unto thy children. Now, you notice when he shifted from our to thee and thy, that meant we stopped talking about the whole group and we started talking to individuals. But I mentioned that we're going to divide all these into two groups. What are the groups? Children is one group. Parents is the other. So these words are dealing with parents. Do we all agree? You see the wording? Thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children. Now, you might say, well, that still could imply that we could have a school out here in the desert, in the wilderness, and we'll bring all the children together and we'll have a teacher, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80. We are thankful for the size classes we have. But I know when I was first here in India in 94, Chandrasekhar Ida's sons went to a school where I think there were 70 or 80 students in each class. And not only that, but they had two different sessions. One session would come in the morning and they'd have that many, and the others would come in the afternoon and they'd have that many in each class. But that can't be what's referred to here because of what it says later. Let's keep reading. Thou shalt teach them diligently. You'll repeat it, drill it in unto thy children, and thou shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thine house. Notice it doesn't say when thou sittest in thy school. Correct? Is that clear? How does it read in your Bible? Is it when they're sitting in school or when they're sitting in the home? In the home. Can we somehow allow our mind to grasp what's being said, what's so obvious here that so often we miss? So we are sitting at home, and you're supposed to be teaching, drilling it, repeating it. And when thou walkest by the way, so I'm at home, now I'm walking. And so while I'm walking, I'm teaching, I'm drilling, I'm repeating all the words of God to whom? My children. Somebody else's children? No, it says my children. When I'm sitting in the house, when I'm walking in the way, and when thou liest down, and when thou risest up. It sounds like 24/7 to me. 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, is the responsibility of godly parents with their own children. Not only will you talk about it in all your activities, whether you're sitting, whether you're walking, whether you're lying down when you're getting up, but beyond that, there's even more. And thou shalt bind them for a sign upon thine hand. You've seen maybe some pictures of Orthodox Jewish people where they have things wrapped around their arm and a little box with some scripture in it. Sometimes you'll see it with a little box on their forehead wrapped around and so forth. The little box has a portion of scripture. And they take literally what's said here. But obviously, Moses is saying, you need to bind more than that little scrap of paper that you have inside your box. You need to cover the Word of God, and it has to be so close to you that it's right there. You could see it and pick it up and use it. Not only binding them for a sign upon thine hand, and they shall be as frontlets between thine eyes. So it's right here. You can see it. And thou shalt, and not only that, thou shalt write them upon the posts of thy house and on thy gates. Well, number one, this shows that Israelites could write. Some people say that they did not know how to write. There was no, only scribes could write at that time. But that's usually written by unbelieving scholars, and they assume things that they should not assume. This verse tells us the average Israelite could write. They were supposed to write. And in fact, if you look back in time, the writing became much simpler in the time of Moses. About that time, we see alphabetic writing, not pictorial writing. In Chinese today and in the old Egyptian, every idea had a symbol. And you might have 500 symbols or 1,000 symbols. And you have to remember what the symbol was. It stood for this, stood for house, this is for son, this is for daughter. Okay, this is for field, this is for wheat. All right, there was a symbol for everything. But about the time of Moses, as far as we can tell, language became alphabetic, where a letter represented a sound. Aleph, Beit, Gimel. Aleph was A, Beit was B. All right? Each letter represented a sound, and so they had to think of a word and then picture what are all the sounds in that word and match that up with a letter. And so you have an alphabetic language, which is one that children can learn. I grant this, and so does everyone, that when it was so complicated with all the symbols that were there before, that only the most intelligent could write. And they were the scribes. But by the time of Moses, and especially here, and especially since they have 40 years in the wilderness to learn some things, they can learn an alphabetic language and write it. So, and thou shalt write them where? On the post of thy house. There should be scripture here, scripture here, scripture here. And on thy gates. When people come in the gate, oh, here it is. The Word of God. Do you get the picture that the instruction for spiritual matters was at home? It was not at a school. In the Old Testament, God gave parents, not schools, the full-time job of training their children spiritually. This is spiritual homeschooling. Do you know that phrase? I think it's relatively uncommon here in India, but there's a place for parents saying, I will be the teacher. I will make sure they know the books of the Bible. I will make sure that they're memorizing, and I will check them. I will check them from the earliest ages on up. Now, by the way, just for a little encouragement, if you have memorized like chapters at a time, it's easy to review that. If you memorize like 600 verses, individual ones, how do you review that in your mind? Let's see, I did 23 and 24 yesterday. Now I'm going to do 25, 26 today and 27 and 28 tomorrow. All right? It's hard to remember verses that way. But if you remember chapters, it's easy just to go over when you're driving, when you're walking, just to be able to go over those verses and let the truths of the Word of God sink into your heart. The joy of all this is while you are saying this, your children are learning it. That was the surprise to me. My wife and I would often just go through several chapters while we're driving. If it's a 20-minute walk, or I don't know what it would be for you, but often it was a 20-minute ride in the car. And so we'd go through some scripture. And before long, the children were repeating it with us. They didn't even have to work at it. It just came. The son who was with us back whenever that was, 2016, the only son who ever came here, was most unusual. I would be working on memory because I was having the Bible class memorize the Sermon on the Mount. And that's not an easy job. So here I was struggling, trying to memorize this before I would teach it to the young people that I taught. And in the process, we had just gotten the boys up, and they were supposed to get up and get dressed, wash their face, get clothes on, come out, help get table set, and we're going to have breakfast. So they would be walking in and out while I was memorizing this. I was doing this out loud. And what was such an amazing thing to me, while I'm working, let's see, what's the next word? He would tell it to me. He wasn't even sitting next to me. He was walking in and out of the room, but he memorized what I was saying that easily. Now, I think some people can do that better than others. That does not come that easily to me, but it does to him, and maybe to you too. But you can easily take passages of Scripture, memorize them, and go over them with your children. Spiritual homeschooling. In the New Testament, we see Ephesians 6:4. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. When we see the word provoke, a negative example of that, Paul said, don't do this. But we know of at least one case that we've seen, if we've watched the films, of someone who provoked, and that would be Josh McDowell. I think that was one of the first films we showed back in June. Those who were here remember that he grew up in a home where his father was a drunkard. And one time in particular, his wife came down to the barn where he was milking the cows and was complaining about how they were, about all the cows complaining. She could hear that up in the, at the house. He had not done a good job milking. And you know how cows, if they're not milked, they're going to let you know they want to get milked. I assume you know that. Do you? Anyway, if you don't, you do now. They will tell you it's time to get milking. My father-in-law had a dairy farm and a potato farm, so we understand a little bit about that. But he was there and was very slow about getting the cows milked, and they were mooing and groaning and complaining so loud that she heard it up at the house. So she came down and said, what's the problem with you? Do I have to do everything for you? And blah, blah, blah. He was drunk. He took one of the straps that they use to harness the horses to the whatever they were using at that time, and he took that and just beat his wife mercilessly. He heard that while he was collecting eggs and came and just knocked him over and put him up against the wall, and he said, you ever do that again, I will kill you. Does that sound like wrath? In fact, he spent most of his growing up years trying to find ways that he could kill his father and not get caught. He mentioned that. That's provoking children to wrath. There are many, probably many ways of doing it. And I have to confess a problem I have when I come to this verse. I try to think of examples, and I think of that because we saw it in the film. And I can understand it there. But my father never provoked me to wrath. You say, did he ever discipline you? Oh, my, did he ever discipline me. He liked to take his belt off, and I knew there were problems. He'd hold me one hand, and we'd go round and round and round. And I mean to tell you, it hurt. But did that make me angry? Did that make me wrath, full of anger and anger? No, I deserved it. I knew I did. But I don't have experience of my father provoking me to anger, to wrath. I asked my wife, what about in your home? Her home was very similar to mine, and there was much punishment. And she would say, yes, it was deserved. But it never brought her to the place of wanting to kill him. Okay. And she never knew of a time that her father provoked her to wrath. And so I'm short of examples, but maybe you have plenty. I've heard so often testimonies among among our young people, and I've said this, so excuse me if I've done it before. Their testimony is, our family is Christian in name only. The second sentence, my father was a drunkard. That breaks my heart. I've heard that over and over and over. So you probably can give many more examples of what it's like to have a father who is provoking you to wrath. If someone would have talked to Paul and said, Paul, what do you mean? You're not supposed to provoke them to wrath, but to bring them up in nurture and admonition of the Lord. I'm sure he probably would have pointed to Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 9. This is what it means to bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. This is how you take care of your children. This is how you bring them up. You teach them while you're sitting. You teach them while you're walking. You teach them while you're lying down. You teach them while you're getting up. You're teaching, teaching, teaching all the time, repeating, repeating. That's how you bring up children, in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. So I would assume he would have gone to Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 9. Now, in this verse, we see the word fathers. And ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath. The Greek word translated fathers could be translated parents, as it is in Hebrews 11, 23. That verse reads this way. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hid 3 months of his father's. That's literally what it says in Greek, of his father's. And obviously, he only had one father. And so that has to mean parents. And so when we read parents in our translation, that's a good translation. But that teaches us something, that even though it says fathers, it's probably including the mothers as well. In fact, I'm going to be so bold as to say, each mother also has a huge role in training her children spiritually. They learn so much in the first few years of their life, and it's during those years the father's out busy doing work, and the mother needs to take over. So all the information we got from Deuteronomy 6 about loving the Lord with all your heart and having the word in your heart, in your mind, and in teaching and so forth, that applies equally well to the women, to the mothers, as it does to the fathers. So basically, when I deal with Ephesians 6, 4 with us here, we're dealing with everybody in the room. Some would say then, is it wrong for the young people to get together and have a time where they enjoy themselves together doing something or having a Bible quiz? No. So youth ministries are not wrong. Extra activities, not specifically given in the scriptures, are possible. And I give for your consideration, men were appointed in Acts chapter 6 to feed the widows in the church. I don't know that Jesus ever said, you know, when you get to forming a church, you need to appoint a committee so the widows can be fed. But it was a need, and so they met the need. And there's probably times when young people want to get together and do things. Well, fine. No, youth ministries become wrong if they replace or ignore parents. We must not ignore the primary role of fathers throughout the Bible. Fathers are the elephant in the room of those planning a youth program. And I use this as a illustration. Here you have youth group, let's just say, youth group leaders. They're sitting around the table. What are we going to do next Sunday? Where are we going to go on our trip? And what are we going to sing? And so forth. And they have all this in mind. They've got this planning that they want to do, but they're ignoring the elephant in the room, and that is that the Bible says it's the father's job to do all this. I understand that you have a different use of that expression, elephants in the room than that. So I wanted to make sure that was clear. Okay, can you imagine the difference in our churches if all the time and the effort and the money now spent on youth work were redirected to preparing parents for biblical homeschooling? Can you imagine what churches would be like? I'm going to go through this quickly. Our time is about maybe over by quite a bit. The advantages of spiritual homeschooling. I'm just going to read it and go through. Only a parent can see the overall development of a child from birth to adulthood. Only he knows when a child is doing his best. There are times when a child says, well, I got a 93 mark. And the parent that knows the child says, but that's not good enough for you. You can get 100 easily, and you're lazy for not doing that. A parent knows that. A teacher may not. Usually, it is more effective than typical schooling. How many graduates from youth groups leave the church? Kids too often turn out like their parents in spite of the best efforts of youth workers. A pastor friend of ours said he grew up in a very active, large youth group in the Chicago area. 50 young people in the group. And he said, now meant he's married, has children. He said, now I only know of two out of those 50 which are believing in the Lord. The rest have fallen away. Even though it was a very active youth group. Okay, youth workers can spend more time worshiping, singing, learning, and fellowshipping with the rest of the church instead of taking care of other people's kids. Parents can do much more with their own children than youth workers can. More variety, more individuality, more challenging. I've taken our boys places that I would never take a youth group, whether in the river or up along a cliff, along a mountain, something like that. I can do that with my family because I know them. I would not do that with a youth group. The total amount of childhood foolishness. You remember the verse? Proverbs 22:15, foolishness is bound in the heart of the child. Remember that? The total amount of childhood foolishness is less in a family of six than in a classroom of 20. Does that make sense? The more young people you have together, the more foolishness you have. Parents have more time to spend in enjoyable activities with their families than when their children are attending various youth activities. Okay, so we have boys different ages. Okay, well, the older ones are going here, the younger ones are doing this, and we're just running back and forth, running kids here, there, and yonder. Maybe you don't do that here. Okay, how I yearn that each person here would start planning right now to train their own children spiritually. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this time that we could have together. I pray, Lord, that what you have written would be very clear to everyone here. Help us not to introduce what we think is something better than what you have devised. Help us to come back to you with humility and seeking your desires and not simply going based on what we have done or what we think should happen. Help us to put you first in everything, and then if there's time for something else, to do that. But may you bless as we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
We thank God for that excellent message for us this morning. Now, before we close with a hymn, I'd like to request after the hymn that our dancer would conclude the session with a word of prayer, Dr. Lanminton, and after that, our vice president would close with a benediction.
Let's all stand together once again and sing this hymn. Have thy own way, Lord. We will sing the first and the second, and we will skip the third verse and go to the fourth verse. Let's sing it together. Let's sing it together.
Have thy own way, Lord. Have thy own way. Thou art the potter. altered I will, while I am waiting, yielded and still. Have thy own way, Lord, have thy own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow, Lord, was Jesus now, as in thy presence humbly I bow. Have thy own way, Lord, have thy own way, hold o'er my being. Absolute way, fill with thy spirit till all shall sing Christ only, always living in me.
Thank you. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Yes, sir.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for today, the fellowship we have had together, and we thank you for your word that came to us. Lord, now we pray that you would enable us to follow your instructions. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, love of God, our Heavenly Father, and communion of the blessed Holy Spirit rest and abide with each one of us for now and forevermore. Amen.
God bless you all, everyone.